We would like to thank Storytel for sponsoring this show. Storytel is an audiobook platform that lets you hear hundreds of thousands of stories on your mobile, on your PC, wherever you prefer. You can get a great deal by signing up at the URL storytel.com/IVM. So this week I'm going to recommend Watership Down by Richard Adams. It's a quirky book. It's the story of a group of rabbits, how they face the destruction of their den and subsequent escape and journey to their new home. It's funny, it's heartwarming, really cool. It's basically Exodus with rabbits. I think you'll enjoy it if you haven't read it before. And let me tell you a little bit about where you can go get it. Go get it at storytel.com/IVM. And you know what'll happen? If you go and sign up on this link, you'll get your first month for just 99 rupees a month instead of 299. That's 200 bucks off. Go get this book right now. You'll really enjoy it.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to All Things Policy. I'm Manoj Kevalramani, and today I have with me my colleague Anirudh Kanisetty. And we are going to be talking about a new research document that Anirudh's authored, which is looking at creating a strategy for India from a rare earth point of view, a rare earth strategy for India. But before we get onto that conversation, let me just say that tomorrow is January 26th, which is Republic Day in India. And for all those who are interested, we have a special conversation, a special event planned. We're going to be talking to Lieutenant General Satish Dhua about his new book, India's Brave Hearts, Untold Stories from the Indian Army. This is at 5:30 p.m. Indian Standard Time. You can find all the details on our website, and we'll also share a link to register for the event in the show notes here. So if you're interested, please do join us for that. This is a conversation between Lieutenant General Satish Dhua, hosted by Lieutenant General Prakash Menon. Okay, so now on to today's conversation. Anirudh, let's just first look at why exactly are we looking at rare earths right now? What is the significance of this, and why specifically rare earths?
Hey, Manoj. So there's really three numbers that always arose at the forefront of my mind when it comes to rare earths. The first is just the sheer importance of these elements to the Indian economy. Everything from the LCD screens on our mobiles, which again, keep in mind, generate a huge amount of economic activity through financial transactions, online shopping and so on, to the stuff that manufacture our clothes, for example, the heavy industrial machinery that do that, to futuristic stuff such as car batteries for electric vehicles, all use rare earth elements. I did a little bit of a study before initiating this research document that we're going to be talking about, and basically just put together a list of all the items that India kind of imports and exports that involve rare earths in some form or the other, and the value of them all added to nearly $200 billion. That's not even counting the economic value that comes out of them. So they're extremely, extremely important elements that are really crucial to the Indian economy in a lot of ways. So that's the first number. The second number is that as of today, China controls nearly 90% of the world's rare earth element mining and refining capabilities. It's come to a point where countries that have rare earth deposits, such as Australia, Russia, and the USA, all export their stuff to China to be refined into forms that can be used to manufacture all these high-value products that I was talking about. And as you know, of course, China has a pretty well-established record of trying to use trade as a coercive tool. For example, in 2009, they had a territorial dispute with Japan, and apparently just around that time realized that rare earths had some devastating environmental consequences, and therefore imposed kind of export quotas on rare earths, supposedly for their own internal purposes. But it also had a massive, massive effect on the global economy, leading to a massive spike in the price of rare earths. So this should be a bit of a concern, right? The fact that first, the rare earths are so important to the Indian economy, but also that we're reliant on a notoriously unreliable geopolitical entity to get those rare earths, and more importantly, a geopolitical entity that is in direct competition with us. The third and most important number, which kind of offsets both of these numbers that I mentioned, is the fact that India has the world's fifth largest deposits of rare earth elements. So we have potentially millions of tons of rare earth reserves that are waiting to be exploited, that for various reasons haven't been efficiently exploited as a result of which India remains basically a low-cost materials provider to the rest of the world. Though we do extract some amount of rare earths, it's in such a minuscule quantity that it isn't even comparative with Chinese rare earths, and to the point where Indian manufacturers would rather import finished processed rare earths from China than actually use Indian supply chains for the same thing. And in the coming years, as you can imagine, with American and Chinese geopolitical competition kind of increasing, and of course the fact that China itself is adopting a more belligerent posture. We spoke in Tank Scrub yesterday, Manoj, you talked about how China is likely to just be a little more kind of belligerent this year, especially given that it's got so many important anniversaries coming up. And we've also seen how China is making some pretty bold territorial moves along India's northern border. I think it's fair to say that India needs to really think about all the potential levers that China has against it and think about ways to potentially offset them. Hopefully, there will never be a time when we will have to actually use those levers, but it nevertheless makes sense to kind of build in resilience into our economy for any kind of worst case scenario, because inevitably that's going to end up helping the Indian economy as well. So that broadly is why we decided to set out on doing this project.
I think some of the data that you've provided is really, really interesting. Like, so at one point in time, you tell us that, you know, India trades in nearly $200 billion worth of intermediary and finished goods derived from rare earths every year. Again, and the value generated, obviously, you're not even calculating. This is just an absolute amount, and the value would be far higher when you look at value generation over across the board. So that's sort of one thing that, you know, from an economic point of view also, it's something that's important for us to take note of, particularly when you say that we have the fifth largest deposits anywhere in the world. The other sort of statistic that I found really interesting, and you spoke about this, right, that in 2009, you had this issue between the Chinese and the Japanese, and China imposes this quota sort of export restrictions on rare earths. And at that point in time, China has about 97% of the market that it dominates. And since then, you see the Americans, you see the Japanese, you see others also start to look at, well, okay, look, we need to build resilience. We can't be overly dependent on China, which, I mean, that argument is not as high-pitched as it has been in the last year and a half when it comes to the idea of decoupling. But it's the same argument. And what we have seen 11 years after is China's share come down to 90%, which is very, very, which is sort of insignificant in some ways. It's not, you know, so it just tells you that even today, if you were to apply that same template, let's say with a little bit more sort of on steroids, if I could use that, in the current context, even then it just tells you how difficult any sort of decoupling is going to be, particularly when it comes to things which can be difficult to mine, which can be difficult to extract, and which can be difficult to then polish off and, you know, use, because you need an entire supply chain apart from just having the raw material there.
Agreed.
So, yeah, so I mean, that to me, that was just fascinating from the point of view of this argument of decoupling. But yeah, but let's get to exactly why is it that over this long period of time, having these large reserves, India has not capitalized on it. Is it the fact that we don't look at it as, we haven't looked at it as lucrative financially, or is it that, you know, there is bureaucracy, or is it that just, you know, we didn't realize that we've got these reserves and we're not doing much with them?
Oh no, we're perfectly well aware that we have these reserves. In fact, if you look at the annual reports that the Indian Bureau of Mines puts out, it quite oddly reports from the US Geological Service data that India has 6.9 million tons of rare earths. And we know precisely which states they're in. We have a pretty good sense of what areas, what kind of places, which means, you know, beach sands, for example, or what kind of rivers we should be looking at if we want to get rare earths. So it's not that we aren't aware that we have rare earths. I think the issue here is kind of crossed wires in terms of priorities and the fact that as of 2016, the Atomic Minerals Concession Act has basically meant that only Indian government corporations can mine some of the minerals which contain rare earths. So the vast majority of India's rare earth reserves are in the sand called monazite. So monazite is this kind of dark sand that is found mostly on India's coasts. So for example, Andhra Pradesh has a whole bunch of monazite. Kerala has a whole bunch of monazite. Odisha has a whole bunch of monazite. But because of these 2016 rules, the only folks who are allowed to actually extract from those places are Indian government corporations. And in practice, that more or less comes down to an organization called IREL or India Rare Earths Limited. Now, the thing is that IREL is not necessarily mining these beach sand minerals to get its hands on rare earths. I mean, it's also doing that, but its primary objective is actually to get its hands on thorium, which is also found in these sands, which is an atomic mineral. And there have been very great hopes that have been held out about thorium possibly helping India basically stand alone in terms of nuclear energy generation. But from what I understand through a few conversations with scientists and a little bit of my own research, it's not likely that thorium is really ever going to help India be independent in terms of producing nuclear energy. So that brings up the question. You have this entire organization, IREL, which has the expertise to extract rare earths, but currently works under the Department of Atomic Energy to extract atomic minerals from beach sand minerals, which aren't even going to help with India's overall nuclear energy program. So doesn't it not make more sense to kind of shift IREL's objective to just doing what it's named after, which is to extract rare earth elements? Because until it has that clear focus and mandate on just getting its hands on rare earths, we're going to see a little bit of policy incoherence. So as you can imagine, IREL in the first place is a government-owned corporation, so it's not necessarily fully exposed to market forces. That means on the one hand that it can't really raise the capital that's necessary in order to do a lot of the capacity expansion and kind of build in the extraction capabilities required for rare earths. On the other hand, it also means that because it's not exposed to this kind of price mechanism of global markets, it's able to produce at a very kind of inefficient level. And while it can have like a few guaranteed clients and provide a certain amount of guaranteed quality and quantity of rare earths to them every year, it's not necessarily going to be producing at a scale where, for example, futures markets based in New York would be trading based on IREL, right? Mm. So there's a whole bunch of issues there. A lot of it ties into the lack of focus within IREL and then the kind of handicaps that are placed upon it as a result of being a government-run corporation. So essentially, what India has done, to summarize, is because of 2016 rules, it's given the entirety of the onus of like extracting rare earths to IREL, and IREL, because of various constraints, is not able to deliver to the potential that you would assume that a monopoly grants it.
Okay, that's fascinating. I mean, we'll get to how your recommendations in terms of how to address this, but I also want to look at, one of the things that you've done in the paper, which is you've created a framework within which you look at which of these elements, which of these rare earth elements are strategically important for India. I want you to sort of walk us through what went into that framework creation and how did you assess the strategic significance of different elements?
Sure. So there's broadly two categories of rare earth elements. The first, you can break them down based on their atomic number, right? So the rare earth elements that are lighter are generally more abundant in monazite, beach sand and other resources found in India, whereas the rare earth elements that are heavier are not very often seen in India. Next, in terms of the strategic potential, right? So it's kind of twofold. It depends partially on what they're actually used for in, for example, defense applications or manufacturing stuff that can't be done elsewhere, plus also their economic potential. So for example, if you look at stuff like neodymium, which is perhaps one of the most critical elements of the coming decades, neodymium can be used to make permanent magnets, extremely powerful permanent magnets, which are also very kind of lightweight. That means that you can use them in a huge number of applications. You can use them in, for example, car batteries, or you could also use them in guidance, propulsion and control systems for ICBMs. So there's an enormous variety of potential applications that each of these rare earth elements has. So in the very beginning of our report, we actually kind of grouped together all of these applications. So broadly, the applications that rare earths have in the economic domain include battery alloys, catalysts, ceramics, glass, polishing, magnets, metallurgy, and phosphors. Phosphors are, as you can can imagine are useful because they can help generate laser beams, which are useful in optics and targeting systems, as well as in the optical displays that kind of make up your phones. So as a result of that, like all of these, as you can imagine, have some very important economic applications. Now, in terms of figuring out their economic and strategic importance, we basically kind of tried to give each of these elements a ranking from very high to low. Neodymium, as I mentioned, because of all these potential applications, gets a very high in terms of its strategic potential. Because of its application in magnets, which can be used in, for example, electric vehicles, it gets a high in terms of its commercial potential. Similarly, for every single element. One thing that really came out in doing this analysis was really that it's mostly the lighter rare earth elements that have the crucial strategic applications. Most of the heavier rare earth elements are not necessarily that important and are also not necessarily found in India. So what does all this mean? Basically, it means that the lighter rare earth elements which are found in India are also the ones that are most useful to us in strategic and commercial terms. The heavier rare earth elements which are not found in India are not as useful to us in strategic and commercial terms. So potentially, we can think of trading for them with our partners and look at extracting the lighter rare earth elements from India's own resources. So this kind of mapping exercise turned out to be very useful in terms of figuring out what India's priorities should be.
This is fascinating, right? I mean, it serves in some ways, I mean, the fact that we actually have these raw materials which are available with us to serve both the sort of political need for, and I'm going to use this term, Atmanirbharta, self-reliance, but also the sort of geostrategic idea of, you know, of what we are seeing going forward, which is some form of segmented globalization, particularly in the context of sectors which are significant to national security. You know, and rare earths will be fundamental to that, given that you explained to us their utility across the board, particularly with regard to emerging technologies and with regard to sort of, you know, just digitization, getting people, on board on sort of this in this digital era. So, okay, so let's look at finally, what exactly do we need to change? The case for why we need to change is very clear. The case for why what we are doing currently is terribly inefficient is very, very clear. So what do we do to change?
Okay, so simply put, kind of calling back to what I was saying earlier in terms of the kind of crossed wires and mixed up priorities that IREL is kind of grappling with right now, the single biggest takeaway is that you need a new kind of department that is focused purely on getting its hands on rare earths. So we are proposing the foundation of a Department of Rare Earths. And we're saying this department should not be under or linked to the Department of Atomic Energy, but rather under the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas. Because the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas has a fair bit of expertise when it comes to exploring for allocating resources, working with the private sector, working on extraction and refining facilities. And we think that that kind of expertise would be very useful to a potential Department of Rare Earths. Of course, the Department of Atomic Energy has considerable expertise by virtue of having supervised IREL for all these years, and therefore members for the DRE should be kind of seconded from the Department of Atomic Energy. Now, this Department of Rare Earths would basically do something similar to what the Telecom Department does, which is to oversee the formulation of policy and focus on attracting investment and promoting research and developments in the rare earth space. It should also do something akin to creating a rare earths regulatory authority that would basically look after resolving disputes and ensuring that various private sector actors that enter into the space are following the guidelines of the laws. One major issue that India had, especially in the 2010s, was that a lot of the subcontractors who were going out and like doing beach sand mining to get their hands on rare earths or get their hands on thorium were basically releasing radioactive and poorly processed effluents into local groundwater and freshwater supplies, which is absolutely ridiculous and like it cannot be stood for. It's against the national interest to basically extract our minerals, but at this terrible environmental and social cost. So you need to have a regulatory authority that's able to ensure that companies are sticking to environmental regulations in this space. Now, once this Department of Rare Earths is actually formed, it kind of depends on what it does really depends on what India is looking to do. Now, in our document, we propose three different approaches. The first is the mineral first approach, where the objective is to just get our hands on strategic rare earth resources without necessarily worrying too much about global market forces. Why? Because if you were to set up these facilities that are going and like extracting and mining beet sands or going into like the jungles of Chhattisgarh or Jharkhand and trying to get their hands on these rare earth elements, inevitably they're going to be very, very expensive to set up, as a result of which they're not necessarily going to be very cost effective, especially if you're trying to sell on the global market. So this basically envisions a policy where the government is funding private sector actors to go and extract rare earth elements, which will feed into India's defense industries, of course, with critical, with very well-enforced environmental safeguards. This is if we were to just, you know, try to focus on getting our hands on the minerals themselves. The second approach is what we call the demand and application first approach. Now, this is more of a kind of world-facing approach, where we try to imagine that India is going to produce rare earths for the world in the same way as it kind of produces steel and aluminium for the world. So what this requires is that you need to set up facilities near ports, for example, where Indian companies will be able to import basically rare earths in their oxide form from across the world and then do processing on those rare earths to produce stuff that can be exported at a much higher economic value or perhaps feed into Indian industries. So this, as you can imagine, would require a good deal of infrastructure to be built in Indian ports. It would also require a slew of ease of doing business measures to actually get these companies to set up shop, enable them to work in a profitable manner. Third and the final approach that we are proposing is called the geostrategy first approach. Now, this is more of a kind of a worst case scenario in case some shady business is going on with global rare earth supply chains. And that would involve India basically working with international partners. So for example, India would extract lanthanum oxides from its beet sand minerals and send them to perhaps Australia for processing and get a neodymium in exchange, you know. So it's basically a more coordinated approach, which would involve trading various forms of rare earths with various countries to kind of build up a strategic reserve that all these countries can draw from. This would probably be the most resource intensive, paradoxically, of all of these approaches, because it would require the Department of Rare Earths to work with the Ministry of Commerce, the Ministry of External Affairs, Ministry of Defense, and of course the Prime Minister's office to really get all of this done. So there's really a trade-off involved in all of these, right? So it really depends on what India wants to do. It depends on the kind of resources that it's willing to spend, and it depends on the kind of environmental trade-offs that it's willing to make. But all of them will potentially be far more efficient than our current strategy of basically playing the game with one hand tied behind our back, and will hopefully meet our strategic needs, especially of the changing century, in a much more efficient and cost-effective manner.
No, that's really well explained. I mean, I think that makes a lot of sense. I mean, basically, we're saying that the government needs to, the state needs to sort of get out of the business of doing this business and actually enable things, regulate the sector better, and enable the private sector to do it, but not just through creating rules and making sure that those rules work well, but also making sure that, given that this is a strategically important sector, making sure that there is specific incentives and funding that is directed towards these entities to be able to carry out these businesses, because these will be also resource intensive. And I'm sure that, you know, the sort of the time taken from sort of investment to realization to profit is going to be significant, and therefore the state needs to step in because of the strategic significance of this also. Yeah. And I think that's an interestingly argued proposal in this case. Right. Now, this has been fascinating. This has been really, really interesting. I think it sort of clarifies a lot of what we need to do and why we need to do it, and also how we can actually go about doing this to create a strategic framework for looking at rare earths. And again, something that's really important because it's not often discussed over the other sort of things that the mainstream media tends to focus on. But I mean, fascinating report, Anirudh. Thank you so much for this conversation. I think we'll link the report to this episode, so if you folks want to read it, and I think we've also got a video that we are working on with this, and so we'll try and link all of that. So if you would like to just follow that also, it will be available for you. Thanks so much, Anirudh.
Thank you, Manoj. My pleasure.
If you liked our show, Don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is at IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle at TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
I hope you enjoyed that show. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Like to thank the sponsors on the network this week, Storytel and The Whole Truth Foods. Thank you for supporting us. We have a new show out this week, Candid Kannan with Siddharth Kannan. Sid K is a well-known RJ. He has an incredible show with some of the most amazing Bollywood celebrities. As part of the first week's episode, we're releasing 5 episodes at one time, so you can get your fill of Sid. You can hear him talk to Varun Dhawan, Anil Kapoor, Anurag Kashyap, Bhumi Pednekar, and a whole lot more. This week on the Edges and Sledges podcast with Varun, DJ and Ashwin, hear them talk about the historic victory that India achieved at Gabba. Maruk and Nayath had an amazing talk with Gulpanag. They spoke about the farmer protests and why Bollywood celebs are acting the way that they are. And finally, Shunya One is back this week. Shiladitya and me talked to Anirudh Singla from Pepper Content. We have a great lineup of guests coming up in the coming weeks, including Deepak Abbott, the co-founder of India Gold. Definitely check that out. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
जिंदगी डायरीज के पन्नों में कुछ पुरानी यादें, समुंदर किनारे झूमते दरख्त, जवान दिल की धड़कनें और अनजान मुलाकातें हैं। तो आइए खोलिए मेरे साथ जिंदगी डायरी के पन्ने और साथ ही खुलकर जीते हैं जिंदगी। आप सुन सकते हैं जिंदगी डायरीज IVM पॉडकास्ट ऐप या वेबसाइट पर या जहां कहीं से भी आप अपने पॉडकास्ट सुनते हों।